Even as authorities round up suspects, there are lingering questions about who exactly masterminded the attacks and whether they could strike again. Joining me now from Philadelphia is former director of defense policy for President Clinton, Joe Sestak. He is also a former U.S. congressman and director of the Navy's counterterrorism unit. Appreciate your time, sir. And we get started with this and knowing, based on what we know and what we're learning about the suspects so far, knowing that at least one of them entered via Greece as a refugee and one with a Syrian passport, is that what stands out to you most?
What stands out to me most is that ISIS can no longer be looked at as just a terrorist threat. Oh, it's that. But we have to recognize that this is a wannabe aspiring state, and now it controls territory in Syria and Iraq that is actually the size of Belgium. It controls a population the size of Norway. It has $600 million a year flowing into its treasury. It has $2 billion in assets. And now, over the last couple weeks, it has begun a foreign policy, like Libya did, of state-sponsored terrorism. If we don't recognize it like that, we'll have the wrong strategy that is going to close that state down and protect us, which means two things. Our strikes can no longer just primarily be to help the Kurds and others to go against them militarily. We have to strike the strategic targets of the oil fields, the headquarters, that we know where they are, in Raqqa and other places of this wannabe state. And number two, most important, the political bringing together of a coalition of those who are often our adversaries, like Iran and Russia, that they are going to be the ones that are going to be down there with their influence, I understand, making sure on the ground they are taking care of ISIS. But number two, we will have to accept some changes like Assad, who doesn't directly threaten us, but does actually have some desire to stay there that Russia and Iran want. And in dealing with this political, we can no longer permit others to be doing the bulk of the work, but not under our leadership. The change we have to have.
Well, you're talking about that change, but when we're saying now, I've heard this so much over the weekend that this is a game changer when it comes to ISIS and the new front now that we've been seeing, and also the underestimation of ISIS going beyond the Middle East and Northern Africa. And you're talking about the changes that need to be seen. How can that be attacked politically and diplomatically when many see that that's the initial step that needs to be passed before action is taken?
You're absolutely right. It can only be handled for our security as well as others by U.S. leadership that begins to have information flow back and forth. Let me give you two examples. One, when Russia came in, our primary focus was not to work with them passing intelligence. It was to make sure we deconflicted our aircraft. We set that limit. No, we can't do that. We need information flow. Take Egypt. They have yet to give us information of what really did happen with that aircraft of Russia's that was blown up. So in order to handle this, we have to do what we did in days of old when there was a balance of power. We worked with the Soviet Union against Nazi Germany. We worked with other nations against state-sponsored terrorism of Libya. And that is where we have to take the leadership under John Kerry and others to bring together a coalition of convenience in order to stop this threat.
Well, the information flow, as we've been seeing, is taken on a whole new dimension with ISIS, with encrypted communication, and also now that we're seeing slipping through the migration crisis there and going through the borders. A former congressman and U.S. Navy Admiral Joe Sestak, appreciate your time.
Thank you.